I'm Rick Emerson. How do you chronicle the most influential pop songwriter of the 20th century, maybe of all time? Where do you even begin? Today, we'll talk to the man who tackled and accomplished that Herculean task right here on Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. I am Rick Emerson, and welcome to Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV. In the pantheon of rock, British rock especially, there are generally accepted to be three crown jewels, a sort of holy trinity. These are the Rolling Stones, the Who, and the Beatles. Now, how each of these bands, each of these groups of men, went from their modest beginnings to their eventual triumph is one kind of story. How a nice, clean-cut boy from a good home ended up chronicling one of these bands and one of these bands' founders, well, that is a different kind of story altogether. Here to give us a bit of a window into this tale, Oregonian features writer, author of Catch a Wave, The Rise, Fall, and Redemption of the Beach Boys, Brian Wilson, and the upcoming book, Paul McCartney, A Life, in stores everywhere, November 3rd, available for pre-order now, Mr. Peter Carlin. Hello, sir.
Hello, Rick. It's nice to meet you.
How are you today?
I'm fine.
On the classic 1 to 10 scale.
Ooh, I'm at the place where the face is getting a little frowny, but he's not ready to push the button for morphine just yet.
I don't think that's a numeric scale of any kind, but we'll plunge on ahead undaunted.
Okay, it is. They say 1 through 10, and they show you the little card in the hospital that has the face going from smiley all the way down to looking really sad, which is hit me with a needle right now, lady.
Are you telling us that you have, in fact, been dosed with morphine for large periods of time at some juncture in your life?
No. But when I tore my hamstring this last summer, and then I ended up in an emergency room where they were showing me the card.
Like a picture menu for agony?
Yeah, it was. It was. I'd like the that seriously, right, yeah, the serious agonistes now, please.
As they used to say in the Phantom comic strip, they would do this about every 6 months when they would reset. They would say, for those who came in late, and then they would do a sort of previously on the Phantom. Previously on Peter Carlin.
Yeah, right.
Writing for the Oregonian, written for People magazine as well, the Beach Boys book, Brian Wilson. I guess the obvious question is, why another Beatles book? Why another Paul McCartney book?
It's the thing that, here's my measure. I go looking around as a guy that's interested in the topic, and I want to find a particular kind of book about this subject that's going to answer the questions that I have. And, or at least written in a way that I think is sort of cool and entertaining and full of, wit and intelligence. And then I don't find it. I don't find the book that I'm looking for. So then at some point, then I get all attitudinal, and I figure, well, screw it, I'll write the book. I mean, what the hell? That's what I do, right? I already got the word processor. So then I like crank out a little proposal, and then you sort of fool someone into actually saying, okay, go ahead and write the book.
I'll fund this crazy venture of yours about this Paul McCartney fellow.
Right, exactly. And so that's just how it works. And then in the end, you read it when it's all done, after all the agony and anxiety and screaming at your loved ones that go into it. And at the end of the process, if you're lucky, you read it and you go, like, I'm not too embarrassed by this. This is actually kind of working out.
Sounds like Mrs. Carlin may have a book in the offing as well.
The tell-all.
Do you enjoy writing? You mentioned agony, and I've heard a lot of authors say that they are compelled to do it, but they don't like doing it.
Well, you can't, compared to what? Like, digging ditches is hard work. In the rain, like it's raining today, like that's extremely hard, unpleasant work. There's lots of like repetitive stuff that really is painful. And I can start any given week and feel like this is gonna be fun. I get to think about stuff that I care about and listen to music and buy records and sit down and write like the same stupid stuff I used to write as a 17-year-old, only now I'm like significantly older than that and have bamboozled people into paying me to do this. So so that's like a good day. But then on the other hand, you actually have to sit down at some point and, some people actually literally tape themselves to their chair and organize your thoughts. And that can be a difficult, it's not always easy. And you tell yourself like, oh, it's so painful. Oh, I'm suffering. I'm sitting here and I have to think like, what do I really think about Revolver? And it's like, but a lot of that is just self-pity. But that's a large part of the writer's tool chest.
You mentioned something a few minutes ago that I've also heard a lot of authors say, which is that the idea came from going and looking for a book and you couldn't find it. And you said, well, by God, I have to write it myself.
Yeah.
What was missing about Paul McCartney? What book couldn't you find?
the one that sort of, you know, you want to, what's interesting to me about these guys, or the thing that I try to get into, what I'm most interested in finding out is, at what point does someone's just normal life, and these are normal guys with normal friends who are smart and cool and fun, and they hung out with these other smart, cool, and fun guys, but some guys are just like capable of otherworldly things. And Paul McCartney turned out to be one of those guys, and met up with yet another one, John Lennon, who lived a mile away, and they started hanging out together. So it's the point. But what's interesting to me is talking to the guys that grew up with them, went to school with them, and are still not very, love them, and maybe still keep in touch with them, but aren't like otherworldly impressed. They know who these kids are. They watch them lace up their shoes, and did their homework with them, and walked to school with them, and tried to pick up girls and failed and did all the normal things 15-year-old kids do. Only, these guys were in a band. But I had friends that were in a band and they just didn't turn out to be the Beatles.
You mentioned that having the otherworldly talent and much less two of those guys in the same band.
Right.
Did Paul realize at a certain point, did he realize how special he was? Did he recognize the fact that he had this sort of cosmic gift?
I think that you sort of know it on a visceral level, or you sort of you need to believe that that's true, and you're looking for affirmation along the way, and when you get it, you keep moving in that direction, And they were unbowed by a lot of downturns, a lot of bad feedback, a lot of people who said you're just never going to make it, like this isn't going to happen for you guys. You guys, in essence. Suck. And but they were just like, we don't care. And they invested more time and energy in themselves and kept going. And then they went off to play a club in Hamburg for months on end and knew nobody and did nothing but play music pretty much 18 hours a day. And and that was, I think, a pivotal moment in their lives.
We're talking to Oregonian Features writer Peter Carlin, whose new book, Paul McCartney, A Life, is in stores everywhere on planet Earth, November 3rd. Continue our discussion when we return right here on Outlook Portland on Northwest 32 TV.